Hello and welcome to another edition of This Is Rock and Roll, a show that features the stars of the music. My name is Dennis Dion Nardone. Happy to be here. And tonight's show is something very, very special. The mighty Tokens are here, led by, of course, the one and only Jay Siegel. Yeah. And I'm looking forward to a great show today. Let me say hello. We'll start off with Jay.
How you doing, Dennis?
Let me shake your hand, man. This is
happy
an honor.
Happy to be in the Bronx.
This is an honor. Yes, Jay Siegel, the mighty voice, the original voice of the Lion Sleeps Tonight. And, of course, to my left, Mr. Kurt Frenchie. Frenchie, tell him your last name because I'm not even going to try.
Kurt Yajin. It looks much harder than it is.
Yes, and, of course, from the Bronx, Dr. Gabe Dasson. Doctor?
Mr. Nardone,
welcome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for coming down. And I look forward to the show. I want to talk all about the Tokens. And of course, so we got to start off with Jay. We got to start with Jay. Jay, Abraham Lincoln High School in Brooklyn. And if I remember, you started off with a group called the Linktones.
You do remember correctly, yes.
And there was a guy in that group that said, "Hey, I heard you sing on the beach. You got a pretty good voice. You want to join the group?" Is that a true story?
Actually, I met him. We were in the chorus in Lincoln High School. He was a year ahead of me. Mm-hmm. And he said he was starting a rock and roll group. And would I come over to his house? Of course, he liked my voice. And he asked me to come over to his house. He lived about five blocks from where I lived, and try out to be in this new group. And I sang a few songs, and I passed the audition.
You passed the audition.
And the kid's name was Neil Sedaka.
Neil Sedaka.
His name is still Neil Sedaka.
It's still Neil Sedaka. And you're just still Jay Siegel.
And that's how we started the group. You know, it was myself, Neil, and there was a girl in the group. Her name was Cynthia Zolodin, mm-hmm. and Hank Medris. And we became the Linktones, Lincoln High School Linktones.
Linktones, yeah.
And then, it evolved, later on down the road. It became the Tokens.
Right.
But not the subway Tokens.
No.
Not the bus Tokens.
The Brooklyn Tokens.
We were the Tokens of affection. Tokens of love. Why would we name ourselves after a bus token or a subway token? It was the Tokens of love.
Did you know that story?
I know. That's the first I heard that one.
Me either. I hadn't heard that.
How come you don't tell that story on stage?
It's only for the Bronx.
Oh, only for the Bronx. All right. Well, what section of Brooklyn are you from?
I grew up in Brighton Beach in Brooklyn.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
And, in Brooklyn, every high school in Brooklyn had four or five guys with former singing group.
And
we used to hang out, sing in the schoolyard. We used to sing on the beach. Yep. I lived two blocks from the beach, and every few blocks on the beach was a different singing group.
Absolutely. A lot of singers and doo-wop came out of Brooklyn, that's for sure. And, that's a great story, the Linktones, and then Neil Sedaka went on his own, and then the Tokens formed and all that stuff. And so before we get back into the Tokens, let me go to these two fine gentlemen. Frenchie, you got a long history of music, and tell us the story how you started.
Well, both of my parents were musicians, classical musicians. My dad was a symphony conductor, and my mom was still alive, thank God, in 93, Marguerite.
Oh, great.
And she was an opera singer. That's how they met, in the Detroit Opera Society, where we were all born. My parents were born in Detroit. I was born in Detroit. And my first gig was for NBC. I played this little crippled kid named Amal, and it was a Hallmark Hall of Fame every Christmas.
Oh, okay.
And I did it NBC became the first all-color network. They decided to do a color television production of Amal and the Night Visitors beautiful Christmas opera. And they ran it for 5 years, and then the Menotti didn't renew again with NBC. And then I ended up coming to New York. I hitchhiked to New York in 71 when I found out about the auditions for Superstar, Broadway, original Broadway show of Jesus Christ Superstar, which I was fortunate to be cast in, and I was Ben Vereen's first understudy for Judas. And got picked out of that show to do the movie. Then I did The High Priest, Annis. Okay. The High Priest. So I had a lot of different influences, and I've ended up with one of the best guys ever.
Right.
Could not have been better, I tell you.
Now, I met you, of course, you were with the Planetones at the time.
Yes,
and then you moved on with Jay.
Yes,
For whatever reasons, and here you are, and you're having a great ball of loving it. And you can tell on stage the way you talk about Jay, the Tolkiens, and the way you move, you're loving it, and that's great.
He's that kind of, he's so generous as an artist and as a person, too. And he gives us time to really step out and shine.
My guests are the Tolkiens, ladies and gentlemen. Jay Siegel's Tolkiens. Happy to have him here. And, of course, your new addition, Jay, Dr. Gabe Dasher from the Bronx.
That's me.
The Bronx, New York. What section of the Bronx are you from, Doc?
Country Club.
Country Club.
Yeah.
Sounds very elite. Very elite. The Country Club.
You know, you could have said Morris Park or something.
Oh, yeah. I say it, but it's Country Club.
You love doo-wop, right?
Yeah, it's in my blood.
I mean, you love that acapella, that beautiful sound, and you just love that doo-wop. And, of course, I love your rendition when you used to sing Dear Lord and all that other good stuff. But here you are with Jay. How thrilling is it to be with Jay Siegel's Tolkiens?
A dream come true. That's all I can say.
I know when you were asked, you were all over Facebook saying, oh, I'm so happy and this and that. You couldn't say enough about being part of the Tolkiens.
Honestly, Jay approached me about it, and we've been friends for 20 years because we went through Classic Sounds. I was so firstly taken aback by it because, Bill Reed, he's not replaced. It's just I'm there to sing a part, but Bill was a great guy. And to be asked to come in and sing with the Tolkiens, to sing with Jay Siegel, I mean, what a privilege and an honor it was to be asked. Yeah. And then to say, you know what, you're in, I'm like, I was pinching myself.
You passed the audition.
Jay, we just lost a member of the Tolkiens. Tell us a little.
Well, Bill Reed passed
last April.
Almost the year now.
Yeah. Wow.
He was with me for over 30 years, you know. And a great guy, very, very funny, great on stage, very comfortable. And, it was really something when Gabe said, he's not replacing, it's not like replacing Bill.
Yeah,
you know, all of us have our special talent and our special, you know, what we give to the audience. But what Gabe gives to the audience is something, you know, it's something new, it's something wonderful, and he fits right in.
He certainly does.
But let me tell you something. Yeah. When I did speak to Gabe, or anybody that's ever been part of my, you know, of my
sphere
group.
It's
just as important. I said their talent and their vocal ability is 50%.
Mm.
The way they are off stage is just as important. That's the other 50%. And these two guys are wonderful people. I mean, it's the kind of people, like you said, I don't want to have somebody in the group that I don't want to go out with my wife to have dinner with, you know?
Right.
They have to be that kind of person.
You have two class acts, that's for sure.
They're just great people.
And everyone you always had with you were always class entertainers. But and it shows on stage, like I said.
Well, you know, before Kurt joined us, for about 8 years, I had Jay Traynor with me.
Traynor,
he was the original lead singer of Jay and the Americans. He's the one who made their record, She Cried.
She Cried.
Their first million.
That was their first number one record.
He was all
great people. But I think this configuration is probably one of the best.
Yes, it's good. And you tell great stories, the harmonization. And you see, you guys, I just witnessed you guys up there in Mohegan Sun, and you can see how you guys are already clicking together and it just gelled. And, you love the stories.
You
love what Frenchie's talking about you and everyone else, and it just clicks. And the cohesiveness is there. And people love it. They love your voice. And still singing in the correct same key. How do you do that?
Well,
how do you keep your voice going? And we're talking about The Lion Sleeps Tonight in the key of F. How do you do that, Jay?
I have no idea.
He told me a secret.
No.
He rehearses it all the time, a key higher, step higher, so that he can always go back to
I sing in my car, and all the songs that I sing, I do sing all of them in the original key that I recorded them, when I was like 8 years old.
Yeah.
Not really. No.
And he always says, if I don't do it, we may be out of a job. I'm like, listen, I just started. Please.
But, my secret through the years, through the crazy 60s and 70s, my secret was, or is still, is this is my job, which I love, but I have a family and I have a children and grandchildren, and when I finish my job, I go home. And a lot of the guys in the groups in the 60s, especially in the 60s, they didn't go home after work.
They lived
that life when they were off stage, and a lot of them are not with us anymore. So, I guess I attribute it to just having a normal life, aside from, being on stage, which is people don't think that's too normal.
No, but for a singer, to take care of your instrument, it means you're taking care of your throat and your body. And he's been real good at that.
Now, let me ask you, Frenchie. Here you are singing that Kenny Vance thing with kind of Dissolve, and Kenny got sick.
Yeah.
Here comes Jay. He's asking you, what's your thoughts? How did you feel when Jay Siegel?
I pretty much probably the way that Gabe felt, because it was an unfortunate circumstance that brought me into the group, which was Jay Traynor's very unexpected death. And Jay had a bunch of jobs on the book, and the Planetones had stopped working for a couple of months because Kenny had a medical event. And he called Jay and said, would it be okay if I asked,
I called Kenny
and asked Kenny, would it be okay if I asked Kurt to come and do the gig till you get better?
Wow.
And
Right.
Kenny didn't work for the next 3 years, it was one door closed and another one wonderfully opened.
Dr. Gabe, let me ask you this. You're singing a lot of a cappella. You had a group that's winning all kind of awards and this and that. You're singing a cappella. Now, how did you tackle this new edition of, now I'm going to be a backup to Jay Siegel, a whole different format? Did you say this is a great challenge, I can do it, or you had the resume behind you?
Well, you said the word doctor. I'm a surgeon. So I approach everything I do with that same intensity. And, you have to study what you do if you want to do it well.
Yeah.
And, this gentleman here, he assisted me along the way, and I put time into it, and it's an adjustment because his harmonies are not straight harmonies. They're very intricate, and I mean, he came up with some amazing things, and we put a lot of time into making it work together.
One amazing thing he came up with, I see you've got some new moves on stage dancing. Are you teaching him those new moves?
Not at all. I can't dance.
But he's making it all up. I mean, he's just the groove.
I'm sitting with your family, to be honest, and they're saying, look at him move. Look at Dr. Gabe move.
Well, there's
he's
no
dancing.
Beat in a cappella. I could have something to move to.
He looks very natural on stage.
Yes.
And
I fit right in,
One of the greatest compliments that we get, and it's not about the music a lot. It says you guys look like you're having so much fun on stage, which we are.
Yes.
And sometimes I'll step up to the microphone and I'll say to the audience, we're having just as much fun as you guys are, and we are.
But it's a testament to you because it's just comfort. There's not an ounce of stress.
Yes.
Before a gig, it's just he trusts us. We go up and deliver, and there's no stress, and we really do have a good time.
And you know how sometimes the leader of a band can be a real egomaniac?
Yes.
Well, he's
just
not.
A maniac.
You're just a maniac.
But I notice you do take a step back, and you let these guys perform, them talk,
Gabe sings, Gabe is going to be doing some lead vocals.
Right.
You do something now, we do this oldies medley, you do the Sam Cooke. You do the Sam Cooke and
I look forward to hearing that. Yeah,
you know, Kurt does My Girl and The Wanderer, and I said, well, why wouldn't I let him do it? Or not let.
Yes. Mm.
I said, I think he could do it better than I can, and it gives me a break.
And it gives you a break. Gives me a break.
All right, I'm up here with the Tokens, Jay Siegel's Tokens Outlet. The Lion Sleeps Tonight. It was a hit twice. It's around the world.
Around the world.
Two, four, five times. It's got an association with the Broadway play and everything else, the movie. How did it come to Jay Siegel?
Oh, how did I find that song?
Yeah.
Well, many years ago, when I was still in high school, I had a very eclectic taste in music. I like country music.
Right.
I like bluegrass. I like classical music. I like folk music. And I was listening to the radio one day, and I heard a cut from an album of the Weavers. Pete Seeger and the Weavers were, in the 50s, they were the biggest folk act.
One of the biggest.
Bigger than the Kingston Trio, or, you know, they were major. And they played Carnegie Hall. And they recorded a live album in Carnegie Hall, and one of the cuts was Weem Away.
Oh, okay.
And it wasn't The Lion Sleeps Tonight. It was just called Weem Away. And I was in my friend's house, and I'm listening to the radio. I said, wow, I love that. I love he sings it in falsetto and the whole thing, you know. And I taught it to myself, and I taught it to the other guys. And we used to just sing it like to warm up, or, you know, just to sing it to have fun. And when we were signed to RCA Victor, after we had Tonight I Fell in Love, that was our first big national hit record. We then got signed to RCA Victor, and our contract was running out, and we sat around the piano and said, well, what else do we have, you know?
Yeah.
What else can we, for our last, we thought this would be our last session for RCA. And we said, well, let's do Weem Away, you know? And we sang it for our producers. The producers at RCA, Hugo and Luigi, they produced a lot of records from Sam Cooke to Perry Como. I mean, they were like the major producers. They thought, this sounds like it has something that may be commercial. But they thought it would have to have a lyric, because it had no lyric.
Oh, okay.
And they got this, they got together with this guy, his name was George Weiss. And he came up, when I found out what the song was about, and I went to the South African consulate in New York, and they found out that this was a traditional African hunting song, and what it meant is, it was called an African lullaby, and why it was called that is that when the African tribe would go out on a lion hunt, if they would sing this song, like a lullaby, the lion would go to sleep, and then they could make their kill, and then, you know, the village would have lion meat. You know, they have food for the next 3 months. So anyway, that was the story of what Weem Away meant. And he came up with this lyric, "The Lion Sleeps Tonight." Went into the studio, handed me a yellow legal pad with the lyric, and it didn't fit into the original melody. So at the studio, I had to rewrite about 8 bars of the music to fit into this lyric. And we went into the session, and here we had, all of a sudden, there's an opera singer. One of the rhythm instruments is a banjo. Then they have a soprano saxophone, like Guy Lombardo.
And
they're putting this all together. So this record will never happen. You got a banjo.
And an English horn.
A banjo, you got a soprano, Guy Lombardo, saxophone. You have an opera singer from the Metropolitan Opera. Who's going to play this record?
You guys know this story?
Yes.
Oh.
Who's going to play this record? So, you know, the record was released. Uh-huh. And there was a station in Hartford, Connecticut that played the record for the first time. And it just, in 4 weeks, it became number one. And then it became number one. It was on the number one for about a month. And then it was stayed on the charts, the national charts, for three months.
Yeah.
And then it became, a hit all over. It was number one record in 36 countries all over the world.
Yeah, and you guys got to be proud singing it on stage.
Incredible.
With all that. Let me go back real quickly. Growing up, who did you like who was singing? Who did you say,
in the pop scene, I mean, I really loved Stevie Wonder's voice. And, you know, because it came from Detroit, I knew a lot of those. I got
okay.
to meet.
That makes sense.
We were talking about Levi Stubbs earlier, and I got to meet the Tops early on, and and that sound. And Tom Jones, I loved his big sound because I had a fairly legit voice. I could do a legit singing. Yeah. So, you know, and of course,
I'm going to see a Tom Jones song on stage soon, or what?
Dr. Gabe.
Yeah, there you go. Anything but What's New Pussy.
No,
Dr. Gabe, again, you're a big doo-wop, I think, a cappella. You love that beautiful sound. Growing up and getting into the music business, who did you kind of say, I love that guy, I love his voice, I love that sound? Who did you kind of follow?
Well, you know, I was blessed. My father, my uncle Nick was a singer, but my dad was friends with Robert Carr from Robert and Johnny. Oh. And I got to meet Willie Winfield when I was 9 years old.
Oh, and yes, you're a big Willie Winfield.
Then, he has been my guy.
Now, I have to ask you this question. Growing up, you have a nickname.
Oh, here we go.
You had a nickname.
You said
a nickname. A big, fancy, great doctor like you get the nickname Cookie.
Thank you, Sylvia. Thank you so much. Well, it's a true story.
You
just
like cookies,
just like the lion story, it was the first word I said. And in my family, everybody had a nickname.
Right.
There was not one person. I think it got to one generation where it stopped, but up until my generation, everybody had a nickname. It was the first word I said, and my whole family called me Cookie. Jay's like, who calls you Cookie?
My wife
calls me Cookie.
Jay Siegel's Tokens are my guests. Jay, real quickly now, after all these years in the line, we're going forward. You got some new ideas, new recordings coming out. What do you plan on doing?
No, not really. I wouldn't know what to. First of all, there's nobody's. Their records don't exist anymore, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And anything that's, you know, all these artists that are making all these millions of dollars, we made hundreds. They're making net hundreds.
Yes.
You know, it's all hip hop. It's all this kind of thing. And these, you know, I don't know what the market is for. You know, what I intend to do for the future is, as long as this is still here and the notes come out and I'm with these guys, we enjoy working and playing for a live audience.
Yeah, you know, one of my favorite songs is The Portrait. I love that song.
Oh,
but I also like to play on the radio, Please Write.
Well, that's
because there's meaning to that song, and I love playing that song on the radio. Tell us real quickly about that.
Well, we get a lot of requests. We wrote Please, you know, we wrote most of the songs that we recorded. Please Write was written during the middle 60s. And it was written, you know, during the Vietnam War. And if you know, and the lyric, you know, said, please write while you are away. I hope you're going to come home, you know. And when we do it at our shows, I mention any, you know, veterans in the audience.
He dedicates the song.
Or families of veterans. And please, you know, we dedicate this song, Please Write, to all of you guys out there.
Yeah.
And it means,
means a lot today.
I get very emotional when I sing that song.
And Portrait of My Love, I got to tell you, that's one of my all-time favorite songs. I just love it. And I love to go to a concert. And of course, when you sing it, I just love that song. It's just a great song. And I hope you guys enjoy singing that song.
I just heard it on the radio by Steve Lawrence.
Oh, I like it.
He did it.
Portrait. He does it as a ballad. Yes. And I love it. I thought he was a great singer, Steve.
We have about a minute left, but you always talk on stage about that certain time when the British invasion hit and you went into more bringing out groups like The Happenings and the Chiffons from the Bronx, New York.
Yeah.
And that had to be a whole new adventure for you.
Well, you know, the British invasion actually, you know, almost killed the whole, you know, American scene for the music scene. But that's when we had Portrait of My Love.
Yes, you know. Yes.
If we weren't on Warner Brothers, if we weren't on a major label, I don't know, you know, that record could have come out on an independent record. Yeah, nobody would have ever heard it. Yeah. But it was a big hit record, and it was a big hit record in Europe as well.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you what we're going to do right now. We're going to go out with a few videos of the Tokens and finish up the show and let the people see and hear you guys singing. And so with that, I want to say thank you so very much. Jay, Siegel, nice the best, here. One of the best.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much.
Absolutely.
I really appreciate it. I love your music. I love your style. And you just relate to the audience. You let people know, you know, this is music of love. And
it certainly
I love that. Frenchie, always the best.
Dennis, thank you
and
so
all
much.
These years.
For
thank
you. All you do for
thank
all
you for
of
being
us,
a great
man.
Guy and saying hello, taking time, coming off that stage. And Doc, thank you so very much.
My pleasure.
You guys, I look forward to the gelling more of the tokens and more of a, would you say medley of, you got something for the doctor to do a little medley on stage?
Yeah, he's getting real comfortable now.
He's going to put some more dance steps in for you.
All right. Well, anyway, this concludes another edition of This Is Rock and Roll. My name is Dennis Dion Nardone. Once again, a true honor to be with Jay Siegel's Tokens. And everybody, please go out with the videos, enjoy the music, get out and see the Tokens. Wherever you see the name Tokens, get out on that show because they're one of the great performers of all time,
especially
one of the great voices of all time
in
the world of music. So thank you. Thank you to BronxNet. Thank you to Vic Sabatini, producer, director. And thank you once again to our guests. My name is Dennis Dion Nardone. You can hear me on the radio every morning, 7 days a week. Of course, I play doo-wop on Sunday, more of the 60s, 70s, and 80s on Saturday. And of course, we have talk show during the week of Good Morning Westchester. So please join me. Go to my website and Google my name. I'd love to see you guys on the radio. So everybody, enjoy, be well, be safe, and you guys help me out. Here's what how I like to end the show. Everybody's saying, this is rock and roll. Ready?
This is rock and roll.
Yeah.
Hey Al, I got an idea.